So John Dizikes does not need any introduction to you. So I, and he said, so don't. So without further ado, it's a great pleasure. John agreed that he would, originally I asked for a lecture. He said, they asked and it was John's choice to read some poetry and give his reactions to it. So we just want to say thank you very much, John, for being here.
I want to begin by thanking Provost Crosby and saying to all of you that she's brought tremendous energy, imagination to the college. She has many things to do. She has the willpower to do that, but she could use help. Help of all kinds. This is America, and we usually resolve these things into a question of money, and that doesn't hurt. But you could use help of many different kinds.
I'll always be glad for your help. Thank you very much, John.
Yes, indeed. I'm going to read some poetry that I have over the years come to love and be interested in. And I brought together a group that is poems about teachers and teaching and forms of instruction. It seemed to me pretty obviously not inappropriate given the circumstances. So I want to begin. I want to emphasize that I'm talking about teachers, the response of students to teachers, and teachers to students, but also the forms of instruction that have dominated all of our lives. And we begin with that most central form of instruction, the lecture. And the lectures, as you know, grew out of a time when there were no texts, no books, no texts. A few scholars, usually holy orders, went from university to university, Bologna, Paris, Oxford, Cambridge, Heidelberg, and the students, wandering scholars, followed them, listening to the lectures. And it strikes me as ironic or paradoxical, something that we are entering an age when it is said there will no longer be any books, though there will be texts. So what that will do to the lecture as a central form of education remains to be seen. So we begin with a poem about a lecture, and we move to Brooklyn, New York City in the 1850s, Walt Whitman. Walt Whitman, when I heard the learned astronomer. When I heard the learned astronomer, when the proofs, the figures were ranged in columns before me, when I was shown the charts and the diagrams to add, divide, and measure them, when I, sitting, heard the astronomer where he lectured with much applause in the lecture room, how soon unaccountable I became tired and sick, till rising and gliding out, I wandered off by myself in the mystical, moist night air, and from time to time looked up in perfect silence at the stars. Whether you have ever experienced anything like that, I wouldn't presume. The next is a really representative figure, the scholar, professor, doctor, professor, especially in his or her Germanic form, the ultimate image of the great knowledgeable scholar, often pedant, whose concern with students was real, but whose concern would also be with forms and details. And for this, we go from Brooklyn in the 1850s to Vienna in 1900, 1910. It's an extraordinary city, an extraordinary creative time. Klimt in painting, Mahler in music, Hofmannsthal as a poet, Wittgenstein in philosophy, And among all of these figures, there was, though much less well-known, a Viennese journalist, critic, poet, Karl Kraus, the most famous and devastating critic of that entire period. Several volumes of his essays have been published, famous for his devastating, ironic response to contemporary Vienna. And I'm going to read you then a picture of Karl Kraus and one of his teachers, Henricus Stephanus Settlemeyer. And this is Karl Kraus in a surprisingly sentimental mood, mostly. Karl Kraus to an old teacher. I saw you lately as in the days of youth. Your hair was snow white. You cast about your glance as though you sought a word in Latin that had been lost by a luckless student. Another student, not ready for the call, was meant to catch it ere he could catch himself. And if he also failed to do it, you used to call it a mental cruelty. Benignly stringent were you in teaching us. You, kindly teacher, you liked the students well, but closer to your sterling spirit was your concern for a poor word's welfare. Not Latin only, German you also taught. I learned my German thanks to your Latin class. How wonderfully you unfolded German when I had learned to read your dear Ovid. You, kindly teacher, knew all this well enough. You were so lenient, and since I did succeed and passed my test with A's in Latin, you never gave me an F in German. And so I finished, grew, and improved in time because I felt that this much was what I owed you, to meet your standards after high school when I was writing themes in German. Accept this offering as a salute from youth. You stand before me, kindly today as then, in word and picture. You are near me, just as if still I sat there before you. I clearly see you passing your tender hand across your forehead, worriedly, as if you were asked to tend an ailing idiom. Reverent task before soulless listeners. Where did your aging glance, tell me, lose itself, not lost to me? And are you now teaching still the language to a lost, forsaken present? Take my advice, sir, and flunk all the students. Next, a really central form of Anglo-American education, the tutorial. It's one that played a tremendously important role, of course, here in Santa Cruz, in its American form of an independent study. Here we have, not the formal pedantic lecture, for better or for worse, but the individual one-on-one, close, intense study of a text, those famous, devastating words by the tutor, "What, if anything, did you mean to say?" I actually wrote that on stage. Years later, when this student had graduated, very fine, had graduated from law school, he sent me, I think I'd send a note of congratulations, and he sent me back a copy of my comments, having just published a piece in the law school review. But I don't think I did very much of that. I was essentially a piece of fudge.
But was what he said explained?
Who knows? So here we are now, the tutorial in one of the Oxford colleges, actually Christ Church College, a very famous scholar named Neville Coghill, who did a wonderful translation of Chaucer, was the leading Chaucer scholar of his day, and into Christ Church, into his rooms for tutorial, came W.H. Auden, the poet. And Auden later expressed in many forms his gratitude because Coghill was so sympathetic to what Auden described as the feeble and adolescent poetry that he had shown him. So here we have W.H. Auden, eulogy for Professor Neville Coghill on his retirement. Blessed be Christ Church. Now, of the body I brashly came to my first tutorial in, not a molecule remains, but to its mind's eye, optically definite, is our meeting still. This Neville, Coghill, I knew, was not a heroic tenor of the lecture hall, not a disciple hunting Socratic bully, not a celibate glutton, as averse to pupils as to mal-edited texts, yet a don, distinct, as those from the common plump, and as a privy counselor, more deserving of our veil and verge. Endowed with the charm of your Irish provenance, but no proper faults, you countenanced all species. I always respond to this. The alphas, the bone idol, the obstreperous, and the really wrong. Never looked cross or sleepy when our essays were more about us than Chaucer. And no unfinished shy production felt afraid to knock on your door. Among the aging, too large a group disappoint by looking a mess, and even Aphrodite's ex-darlings, who once swanned through the crowds, the stare of all, turn lipless vipers or red-nosed stertorous boars. But you have induced your structure of carbon rings and brine to assume a face that features a self serene yet haggard, a life lived droitly, with the license from now on for any conduct in mild Gloucestershire, whither our love shall follow. May sunbeams falling across your breakfast table forecast new agreeable hours to paint in, rethumb a pet author. Night by night, through your dreams, the sound of lapsing brooks assure you that you pass muster. And of course, though we all know, people talk about the ivory tower and its separation from the realities of life, we know that on this campus, in this college, in the other colleges, and everywhere, every aspect of human life has been revealed. Ecstatic, tragic, pathetic, wonderful, exciting, all of that, everything. And teaching does take place, learning takes place across all the barriers that we know of, race, class, history, character, temperament, gender, all those things. They are there, they intervene, they reshape, but you learn, we try to teach, things happen. And along these lines then, I want to read a poem, Moving to Harlem, Columbia University, in the 1930s, to the American poet Langston Hughes. And his poem, Theme for English B. The instructor said, go home and write a page tonight, and let that page come out of you, then it will be true. I wonder if it's that simple. I am 22, colored, born in Winston-Salem. I went to school there, then Durham, then here, to this college, Columbia, on the hill above Harlem. I am the only colored student in my class. The steps from the hill lead down into Harlem, through a park. Then I cross St. Nicholas, 8th Avenue, 7th, and I come to the Y, the Harlem branch Y, where I take the elevator up to my room, sit down, and write this page. It's not easy to know what is true for you or me at 22, my age, but I guess I'm what I feel and see and hear. And Harlem, I hear you, hear me, we two, you, me, talk on this page. I hear New York, too. Me, who? I like to work. I like to eat, sleep, drink, and be in love. I like to read, learn, and understand life. I like a pipe for a Christmas present, or records, Bessie, Bop, or Bach. I guess being colored doesn't make me not like the same things other folks like, who are other races. So will my page be colored that I write? Being me, it will not be white, but it will be part of you, instructor. You are white, yet a part of me, as I am a part of you. That's American. Sometimes, perhaps, you don't want to be a part of me, nor do I often want to be a part of you. But we are, that's true. And I learn from you, and I guess you learn from me. Although you're older and white and somewhat more free. This is my page for English B. And finally, what it is to be a student, what that entails, how one would define it, how one is shaped by it, what one means by it. And for that, we turn to one of the great individualists of American letters, Marianne Moore. She was born in St. Louis in 1887. She never knew her father. Her mother was pregnant when the father was put in an asylum. He had a breakdown and died. Marianne was raised by her mother and an older brother. They moved to Pennsylvania. She went to Bryn Mawr College, where she did not major in literature. She was passionate about science. She and her mother then moved to Greenwich Village in the late 10s and all through the 20s. And in this place, this extraordinary area that cultivated individuality and eccentricity, she, in her absolutely quiet and proper way, was without a doubt the greatest individualist of anybody, that truly with that inner individualism that shaped her poetry. Poetry like nobody else's. No one has even bothered to try to write like Marianne Moore. She's an extraordinary person, and she lived 59 years with her mother. She, so far as one knows, had no love affairs, no other affairs, She went out into the village, she went into New York, she went to England. She became one of the foremost modernist poets of the 20s and 30s, always in the company of her mother. And yet, out of this came the most extraordinary, I think, body of work, along with that of Eliot and Cowell. And this is a poem called The Student. It's, for me, one of really my favorite poems. And I wanted to preface my reading of it by saying to you that, as you know, I've never been guilty of propagating any theory. I don't have that kind of mind. But there is a proposition I want to offer to you in all humble seriousness that people have underestimated about teaching, and that is, good students make good teachers. And for Marianne Moore, The Student, which I dedicate to all of you. In America, began the lecturer, everyone must have a degree. The French do not think that all can have it. They don't say everyone must go to college. We incline to feel that although it may be unnecessary to know 15 languages, one degree is not too much. With us, a school, like the singing tree of which the leaves were mouths singing in concert, is both a tree of knowledge and of liberty, seen in the unanimity of college mottos, lux et veritas, sapient felice, our own fear lux. It may be that we have not knowledge, just opinions, that we are undergraduates, not students. We know we have been told with smiles by expatriates of whom we have asked, when will your experiment be finished? And we responded, science is never finished. Secluded from domestic strife, Jack Bookworm led a college life, says Goldsmith, Oliver Goldsmith. And here also, as in France or Oxford, study is beset with dangers, with bookworms, mildews, and complacencies. But someone in New England has known enough to say, the student is patience personified, is a variety of hero, patient of neglect and reproach, who can hold by himself. You can't beat hens to make them lay. Wolf's wool is the best of wool, but it cannot be sheared because the wolf will not comply. With knowledge, as with the wolf's surliness, the student studies voluntarily, refusing to be less than individual. He gives his opinion and then rests on it. He renders service when there is no reward and is too reclusive for some things to seem to touch him, not because he has no feeling, but because he has so much. Thank you very much. Would you come, yes, come say what you're going to say, please.
I just wanted to make a brief announcement. Professor Dizikes gave me permission to do so. A group of alumni put together a book honoring the late Duan Joshi on the 25th anniversary of his passing. And we put together a book. It has some contributions, reflections on him by John Dizikes, Professor Dizikes, and Michelle Mather, Noel King, and some reflections by Norman Brown and some of his students. And it's a heartfelt book. And it has some notes towards the end of the book that were taken during some of his classes, which I think are the most interesting part of the book. They're fragments, a lot of them, but they're interesting fragments or rich fragments. And we're selling the book just for any donation that you feel moved to give. And all the money is going to two schools in Nepal, in Kathmandu, that Professor Joshi founded in the late 40s that are still going strong for scholarships for the students. So we're just out there in a little table. If any of you are interested, you're welcome to look at the book.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We have a, I'm not letting you off so easily. So we have about 5 minutes left in this portion. And I don't know if anybody had any questions or comments or, you know, you could raise your hand and say now. Now, Professor Dizikes, can we really change my grade from... no, that's right. You guys didn't have grade.
Do you know what? I was conscious of, I was spared with the pass fail system. 40 years without any of that. Although I began graduate school at UCLA and I was a TA. And wonderful students, and it was pleasant. But every once in a while, someone would come in. Was the B minus, couldn't it be a B? Twice I had blue books turned in with money.
How much?
I don't remember.
That's good if you didn't count it.
To go back to what John said earlier, forget the blue books, but you can send us that money.
Anyway,
will you change my grade?
We really only have time for one or two, but any comments or questions or longings that you want to say right now?
If you want to do me a favor, get a collection, those wonderful collections of the poetry of Marianne Moore, and read the student over and over. And it is what I meant genuinely. It's dedicated, my reading is dedicated to you. And to the proposition which I will enunciate once more. Good students make good teachers. Yes.
Go ahead,
Gary.
And I'll cut you off in about 3 minutes. So go ahead.
In reflection on that and listening to that poem, I think that the greatest piece of having been a part of the class of 71 was the fact that somehow, for all the people I know, it was instilled upon us that we were lifelong students. Regardless of what else we went to do, that things continued to unfold. And it was planful, it was mindful in the part of the university, and it was the greatest gift for coming here we could have. Thank you.
Thank you.
I recall you were my advisor in freshman year, and I recall coming into your office in blue jeans, barefoot, smoking a cigarette with long hair, sitting down, and you saying, well, Mr. Taylor, you're perhaps not quite ready for university life, are you? I was crestfallen recently to find out, talking to other people, that I was not the only one you told that.
I can't believe it. I was walking home from about two, I often do most days, I ride up and then walk down, and a young man was bicycling up Hagar. And he pulled over and waved to me, and he said, my father was a student of yours. He gave me his name. He lives here. But he said, he told me when I saw you to say hello and to remind you of what you said to him. I thought, oh my God, I said so many things. He came into your room, your office, and he said, this is a beautiful place. This is wonderful. I'm going to just enjoy the beauty of the landscape. And you said to him, you better go to the library.
One last question from Jeff.
I just read something in some newspaper, whatever, that someone had done a study that the first 2 years of college these days appears to show no measurable gains in the students. And I read that and said, well, they didn't go to the institution that I went to, obviously, because I felt my first 2 years here with the core class, with the quality of instructors, and also the quality of interactors,
that
scales fell from my eyes. I learned how to think as well as I've ever thought, and I've learned how to write and complete sentences and express fairly complete thoughts, and that is something you don't lose. And I want to thank Cowell College, the university, for that. It's helped me immeasurably in the rest of my life. I walked into a law firm at 40 years old after fishing in Alaska for 20 years and got a job. And they said, well, you appear to be able to write in complete sentences and think in complete thoughts. And most people coming out of law school didn't necessarily master that.
Yes.
So thank you.
And that's a great place to then say thank you very much.